Greetings, everyone. This is Michael again, and welcome back to the channel here on YouTube. Well, as you all well know, I've been giving my thoughts on episodes of the web series Star Trek Picard. And is this episode 8? Or is it episode 9? Has there been 9 episodes? At any rate, this is the episode that predates the season finale. And I'm actually a week behind, but, you know, I could have talked about the episode sooner and given my observations. I just, you know, didn't really think it was a priority, so I got a little bit behind. But I wrote down my priorities on this flashcard here, and I want to talk about some observations that I made from watching the episode, which I always do. If you're looking for a plot-by-plot analysis breakdown of the episode, I am not doing that, but there are a lot of great videos out there where people do that very, very well. I just give my first impressions of the episode, my thoughts, my analysis, if you will. And I write it on this flashcard simply because I have a shit memory and I have to write things down. But at any rate, here are my analysis on the next to the last episode of the season. First of all, let me say that, you know, Rios' ship goes through this conduit that they use to get to Soji's planet in a really, really short time so they can warn them that a Romulan fleet is on the way to attack or annihilate their species or her species. And Narek follows them through this conduit. Now, what I found kind of interesting about all this is that Narek did not radio the fleet. He didn't give them the location of the conduit itself. He basically just followed them through and let his fleet do it the long way when he probably could have got them there quicker, or maybe not, but he could have at least given them the location of the conduit. So, you know, we've heard so much about the synthetic planet, the synthetic life that Soji came from. I honestly was expecting a little bit more pizzazz, a little bit more splash. But when we got to her world, at least from orbit, the planet looked just like an ordinary planet. You know, while everybody's gazing at the screen thinking, oh my God, it's Shakari. It's Eden. It's just a normal drab looking planet. It didn't look any more technologically advanced than any other planet. I was expecting maybe a mechanical looking planet. Something just looked a little bit different, but just a regular looking planet. Now, I know that a lot of people have complained about, you know, the ship's greeted by Narek, who attacks them. And, you know, they end up getting the upper hand on his attack. I kind of thought that, you know, why attack them, Narek? I mean, you've hidden secret to watch what they're doing and all this stuff. Why don't you continue to hide in secret and see what they're up to? I don't understand why you made yourself known and attack them in an attack that, you know, quite possibly you may not win. And he didn't win, but I don't understand his way of thinking there. But that's just me, guys. You know, I'm not a Starfleet captain, so I don't know. But at any rate, they're greeted by these plant creatures. And everybody, you know, a lot of people thought the plant creatures were ridiculous. They're these spacefaring plant creatures. At least that's how they looked. And some of the characters even called them orchids. I didn't have a problem with it. I thought, you know, different form of life, something new. You know, these Star Trek shows are not really known for their originality. So, quite frankly, I thought it was kind of refreshing that we saw something different. Because, you know, in retrospect and thinking about the entire series as a whole, there haven't been really anything original in this show. So I'm not going to bitch at them about the fucking flowers. I mean, give a credit where credit is due. Now, one thing I will say, and this is just like totally out of the park, guys, but now this entire series has been based on the fact that the Romulans want to wipe out all synthetic life because they melded with an entity on the planet that showed them that synthetic life would destroy all organic life. So they took it upon themselves to annihilate all synthetic life. And honestly, I don't understand why their plan included finding Soji's planet, because there has to be universes out there with synthetic life. So why she decided, Admiral O decided to just concentrate on this one group of synthetic beings and make it a priority for the Romulans' destruction, I don't know why they chose that and made a whole organization dedicated to that. When, as I said in other videos, that, you know, humans are just as bad. Romulans are bad. I mean, there's other species out there, the Borg, that are wiping out entire worlds. Why synthetic life? Why concentrate on that? But I don't even understand why, after melding with this phenomenon, why they believed that it was their duty to even attempt to do this. When we find out later in the episode that the message wasn't really intended for them, and they misinterpreted it. They had it in reverse. They were wrong. So I find the whole basis upon which the entire season, the premise, it's flawed. I just don't see Romulans doing what they did in the story. But that's the story, and there you go. My thoughts on it. Okay. I didn't get the whole thing of Picard, you know. When he reached the planet, he goes into this trance and says, "Thank you for coming." I don't get that. It seems like to me they would have communicated with Soji, since she was from there. She had been created there. So I don't really get that. But, you know, that's just me. What else do I have here, guys? This is one of those things where, you know, I feel like this episode, more or less to me, felt plot-driven instead of character-driven. And this is where a lot of this episode, the writers presumed or were very presumptuous in the fact that we as watchers are supposed to presume that there's emotional ties with these characters just because the story calls for it. And there was a lot in it that I didn't really believe, or it felt like a real long stretch, because Picard reveals that he's got this syndrome and that he's dying. Agnes finds out about it, and she's pretty much emotionally struck. And I believe she even cries. And I'm just like, you know, this show, it's painted a universe of Star Trek where it's not the Star Trek that we know. But at the same time, you know, Agnes breaks down and is tearful at the announcement that Picard is dying. And you think, she doesn't really know Picard. She just met him. But at the same time, as a Star Trek show, you would like to think that, well, you know, human beings have evolved. And it's nice to see that just because someone is dying and you don't know him for very long, you can be emotionally attached. And perhaps you're tearful because it's the loss of life. But Agnes doesn't strike me as being that type of person. And furthermore, this show is not that type of Star Trek show. And people don't react the way they would react in a normal Star Trek driven show. So it seems like the emotions that these people are supposed to be experiencing, and Picard tells the entire crew, the emotion, with the acceptance of Raffi, who, you know, has a past with Picard, seems just a little bit of a stretch. Because I just couldn't buy the emotional attachment. And perhaps it's because the season of episodes is just so short. But I didn't really buy Agnes becoming all emotional at the announcement that Picard has this syndrome and that he's dying. Now, granted, I guess it could happen, but it's just not what we've been shown in terms of what these characters are going through and what they are and how they react and how they're so, this show is so different from a Star Trek show. So show, you can't have it both ways. You either have characters that are really in a Star Trek universe or you don't. You don't have it both ways because you paint it such a different world compared to what Star Trek really is. So I just couldn't buy the so-called emotion of these characters. Okay, what else do we have here, guys? And then we have the fact that the Romulans have a fleet of, I believe it was 219 ships. And it's like, okay, Romulans, if you have 219 fucking ships after your planet has been destroyed, evacuate your own fucking asses from your own planet and don't blame Starfleet or Picard. Why you couldn't get your fucking asses off your own planet yourself? If you have this fleet of ships, I mean, I can only imagine that the Romulans, you know, before the catastrophe of losing their world, they had to have maybe even thousands of ships to evacuate their planet. How long did they know before their planet blew up? How much time did they have? But I'm just saying, it's just really unbelievable that they had this many fucking ships in a pinch. In 30 years after their planet exploded, but while their planet was there and thriving and they were a vast military force, why didn't they have enough ships to evacuate? I mean, it's kind of conflicting to me. One of the things that, you know, Picard being reunited with his protector, his Romulan sword guy, telling him to stay on the cube, which the cube also came through the conduit and, you know, crashed on the planet. Picard's ship crashed on the planet too as well. But the cube is still intact. 7 of 9 is there. And Picard and his people end up, the big priority is to warn. The reason he didn't go to Deep Space 12, the reason he forbade that entire journey to get Starfleet to help them and all this stuff, he decided to take her back to the planet. Felt like it was a big rush thing. Had to get there, had to warn them about the imminent attack. And when they get there, instead of walking straight to the community of synthetics, he decides to go to the cube to make sure 7 of 9 and Hugh are okay and all this kind of stuff. Actually, I don't think they knew 7 of 9 was there, but he wanted to check on Hugh and the elf Romulan guy. So, you know, I'm like, dude, you didn't go to Deep Space 12 after you asked Starfleet for help and got told to shut the fuck up. You just go straight to the cube. You didn't go to the aliens that you're there to warn that their race is going to be annihilated, and you go to the cube. Makes sense to me. But anyway, he goes to the cube instead of going to the race of people that he was supposed to be warning, which I thought was just kind of weird. I mean, that's just kind of weird. Go warn the fucking people first and then go to the cube. That's why you're here. That's why you're fucking here. That was just kind of a weird thing to do to me. I just really didn't get that at all. But, you know, he gets to the Borg cube and, you know, The Romulan boy with the sword, a boy and his sword, he wants to accompany Picard. And he tells the boy to stay on the cube, get the cube's weapons ready. And it's like, Picard, this boy don't know shit about the cube. He doesn't know shit about the technology. What? Why the fuck are you telling him to stay on the cube? I don't get that whole storyline. I just don't understand that. Why is he telling him to stay on the cube? He's not a Starfleet officer. He don't know what the fuck he's doing. Why are you telling him to stay on the cube? I don't know. I don't know, guys. We get to the location, the compound of the synthetics, and they're just synthetics in a little city. Nothing overly advanced about them. Just not what I expected. I expected much more in terms of their race, their technology, who they are, what they've constructed. You know, I just expected a little bit more. I didn't just expect a village of synthetics and, you know, that's it. I don't even get why, you know, where Rios's captain ended up, you know, wanting to execute one and he blew his brains out. I don't even get the whole thing with that in relation to this planet and where they came from and all this, why they went to Starfleet anyway. I don't know. I don't know, but it was really disappointing. And then, you know, guess who we see? Dr. Soong's son. Dr. Soong has a son. Okay. This is like just out of the blue. It's just like pulled from somebody's ass. Dr. Soong's son. He had a son. Data had a brother, I guess. I feel like I felt when I was watching Disney Star Wars films that they're just making this shit up as they go and there's no clear storyline. So Dr. Soong has a son here, and he's the one that created all the synthetics on the planet. Picard warns them. One of the synthetics, a female, is quite different from all the rest. I don't know why she's different, but she's conniving. She's contemptuous. She's very different from the rest of the synthetics in that the rest of them are pretty placid. They're pretty curious. They're pretty docile, but she, for some reason or another, is quite different. She's cunning. She's evil. She stoops to killing one of her own to convince the other synthetics that mankind, flesh creatures, are dangerous. She kills one of her fellow sisters, one of her fellow synthetics, just so she can convince the other ones that, you know, we need to go this route. Synthetics are always going to be under threat by organics. We need to wipe out all organics, which means we need to build this transmitter, contact the synthetic intelligence out there. And then we learn, of course, the intelligence wants to kill all organics. So the message was really meant for synthetic life. And the Romulans misinterpreted it as being for them, but it was really for the synthetics, and it was telling the synthetics that they needed to be wary of organic life and pretty much wipe them out. So if they built a beacon to contact this intelligence, it would come and wipe out all organic life, which, you know, why does it need a beacon to wipe out all intelligent or organic life? Why can't it just wipe out all organic life anyway? I mean, apparently it's an advanced form of life. I mean, how advanced is it? I mean, can it just wipe out organic life by itself? Why does it need a beacon? I mean, does it go around seeding planets with this pool of conscious that people just can mind mail with? I mean, it makes no fucking sense is what I'm getting at, guys. It makes no fucking sense. And I guess this intelligence wiped out the planet that the Romulans think that synthetics wiped out, or at least the synthetics that they've been searching for all this time. But in reality, the alien creatures wiped out the organic life on the planet, and their dumbasses misinterpreted, and they're on this killing spree. It makes no sense, guys. The whole structure makes no fucking sense. And this super intelligence is so fucking dumb that it doesn't know how to seek out and just kill organic life. Or has it been killing organic life all this time? And Soji just happens to know how to contact them, how to build a beacon. And then we have a really ridiculous thing in this film where I think the cunning, evil synthetic, I think her name is Sasha. And I could be wrong about that. Maybe it's Sandra, Sasha, something like that. But the point is, she has a love for Vulcan culture. So much so that she studied Vulcans to the point where she can do a mind meld. And I can understand maybe a synthetic being able to copy a Vulcan nerve pinch like Data did. I can understand a synthetic learning how to do live long and prosper. But how do you fucking learn how to do a mind meld? Really? Are fucking synthetics telepathic? Do they have a Vulcan mind? I mean, to me, that's just something you can't learn. But she does a mind meld with Agnes because Agnes was implanted all these memories and shit that Admiral O put into her when she convinced her that she should be on their side and all this kind of stuff. So she minds meld with Agnes and sees all these visions and realized this message wasn't for you. It wasn't for you, Agnes. It wasn't for you humans. It wasn't for you flesh creatures. It was for us. So that's how she gets the knowledge of how to contact these aliens and all this. But she needs to convince her fellow synthetics that this is the right thing to do. Which, once again, is a stupid idea. It's stupid from a story point of view because these fucking synthetics are so fucking gullible. So fucking nonchalant. They have no minds of their own, really. They're idyllic. They would follow a fucking mouse into a mouse trap. So while we have this big story element where she has to kill one of her own to convince them to follow her, I don't know. Because she obviously seems to be a dominant person in their society. Why does she need to create this whole elaborate fucking hoax when she could probably just say to them, humans are a threat or organics are a threat. We're going to do this. And that's what we're going to do. And I'm sure they would have followed her. There is no need for her to create this elaborate scheme and kill one of her own just to do what she wanted to do. Because the way these synthetics are presented is that they're very docile. They would have followed her anyway. They would have followed her. Chalk it up to bad writing. It just did not make any sense at all. No fucking sense at all. And for that matter, Dr. Soong's son, he was all for doing it too. He wouldn't have gave a rat's ass. So all she would technically have to do is say, organics are a threat to us. They killed this person. They killed Soji's sister. They're here to wipe us out. They're on the way. Do you really need anything more than that? You have to defend yourself. She would not have to do any fucking convincing. So that's what I mean, guys. This whole fucking premise, along with the elements in these stories, outweigh anything really intelligent because there's just a lot of dumb shit. And Narek gets captured. She makes a deal, this evil synthetic. She makes a deal with Narek. If you want to get out of prison, do what I tell you to do. It's just really, really, you know, holding up as a story to me, it's just really, you can't hold water with this shit. It's like you can't make this shit up. And it just amazes me that there's a group of people actually writing this stuff. Actually writing. Okay, guys, that's all the time I'm going to spend on that because, I mean, you know, she approaches Narek, tells him if he wants to get out of jail, just follow along. And she had to use Narek as a stand-in for murdering the other synthetic when she actually did it herself. And by the way, she was a copy of Soji. Maybe she was a model and Soji came later. I just call her Evil Soji. But yeah, guys, I found for the most part, once again, you know, it's really, the show has snippets of entertainment, but as Star Trek, it just has no ship to stand on. It's just so much muddling, so much suspension of belief. It's like a group of kids trying to write a story and they just have no fucking idea. Because so much time is spent on stupidity. In terms of a narrative, in terms of a story, in terms of something intelligent, you just have a lot of stupidity. It's like a bunch of kids playing in an adult world trying to write a Star Trek story. So disappointing. So disappointing. And so predictable. I mean, who didn't know what was going to happen by the end of the story and leading on into the next story? So guys, you know, it's all pretty predictable. Evil Soji ends up convincing the other synthetics that this is the right way to go, including convincing Dr. Soong. Agnes is led into Dr. Soong's workshop because she tells them that, you know, she wants to stay with him. She feels like her murder of Bruce Maddox needs to be some kind of consequences for it. So she wants to continue Maddox's work and help Soong. Against helping the people that she's come to know in this show. And by the time you watch this, by the time it ends, you're already thinking, you know what's going to happen in the next episode. At least I did. Doesn't take a genius. But I just find that there's a whole lot of amateur shit going on. And it feels like writers don't have a coherent story. They feel like they have something compelling going on. They feel like they're smarter than what they really are. Whereas, you know, honestly, the whole thing is just insulting. It's dumb. And it just doesn't make any sense. And, you know, there's nothing really new about any of this shit. It's just a whole bunch of gobbledygook fashioned into a story that really just doesn't exceed on any level. And I just feel like if you're going to bring back Picard, he really deserved better than this. But anyway, guys, that's my thoughts on this first episode before the season finale. I'll give my thoughts on the second one in just a bit. But this one, I just give credit where credit is due and bitch and complain when it's not due. And there's just... There's a lot of bitching and complaining about this damn fucking shit, man. I just don't get it. There's really no intelligence in this shit at all.